Thank you for this introduction and thanks for the invitation. My name is Karin Bloksel. I am an urban planner at the city of Rotterdam. And Rotterdam is, like Hamburg, a water city. We owe our existence to our rivers. Our mission these days is to make a park of our rivers. But before I go into that, I will first tell you a bit more about Rotterdam as a water city. Rotterdam is the second largest city of the Netherlands, and we are situated in the Rhine-Meuse-Schelde Delta. The part of the river that runs through our city is called the New Meuse. And within our delta, this is the only permanent open connection to the sea that is remaining. For many centuries, Rotterdam was a small town in a dynamic delta. And the city and its port really started to grow when a new connection to the sea was realized, and this was the new waterway in 1872. So nowadays, Rotterdam has the largest port of Europe, and over time, when ships became bigger and bigger, the port moved to the west, all the way to the sea, where new land was made for this port extension. And nowadays, the port stretches over approximately 30 kilometers from the city towards the sea. And this process of ships and industries moving to the west is still ongoing. So we can say that constant change of the relationship between the land and the water is a fact. This is the place, Kop van Zuid, where the ships departed to America with Dutch people migrating to across the sea. And like many other cities, Rotterdam is transforming places like this into new residential and office areas. This was a big step for Rotterdam in 1996. The Erasmus Bridge was realized and the Kop van Zuid was developed. And this meant that the less wealthy southern part of the city was now connected to the northern part. And it also meant that the city center was no longer on just one riverbank, but on two riverbanks. So this really connected the two parts of the city. And for Dutch standards, Rotterdam has a quite impressive skyline. And this skyline is not yet finished. But I must say that we are increasingly paying attention to the ground level. So we are more aware of the importance of creating places to relax, to stroll around, to be surrounded by green areas. So let me first explain why this ambition and why we use the metaphor of a central park. One of the main reasons is the densification of the city. The growth of the city really makes it important to invest in public space in order to make it a healthy growth. Another challenge is to deal with the heat stress. And the New Meuse is close, let's say, at walking distance for many, many people living in Rotterdam. So this is the ideal place to address this this issue. There are many other reasons, too many to go deeply into right now. One to state. When you squint your eyes, you can almost already see the Central Park. We just have to finish it. All ingredients are present. We have great views, we have parks, we have fun things to do. We have walking trails. So we just have to continue doing this and finish the park. First of all, the New Meuse, although the port moved to the west, the river still is a highway for shipping. So that is something to take into account. And to make clear, this is the exact scope of our Central Park ambition. We have more water than this in Rotterdam. We have another river, we have canals and so on. But the Central Park ambition really applies to this area, the inner city Meuse. And for your orientation, the city center is in the middle of it, and the port area starts over here, which stretches all the way to the coast. Okay, our approach. So what we started to do at first is to make all caves accessible and attractive. By that we mean a minimum of 15 meters of public space where the pedestrian is in the lead, which is attractive and green, where you have benches to sit on. This is again the Kop van Zuid. This is exactly those 15 meters, which really is the minimum. Of course, we want to have, would like to have way more. So if we have the space to do so, we do so. This is the Westerkade. Here we have double the size, so 30 meters of public space at the quays. In order to make these quays accessible for everyone, we, wherever possible, we try to apply a so-called comfort strip, so a strip of asphalt where strollers, wheelchairs, high heels are welcome. Guests are welcome as well, as long as they go slow and behave as a guest, you can see on the picture. Terraces, of course, are also really welcome, but the challenge here is to make sure that we keep this continuous accessible pathway for pedestrians and that this is as close to the water as possible. We are, I guess, doing great work, but we still have a lot of work to do, as these pictures show. Currently, we are working on three major city parks for which land is made within the river. The Rijnhaven Park and the Feyenoord Park are a part of a larger area development, including housing and offices and so on as well. But the Maashaven one is just a park. And I think it's quite special that we are developing at the same time two major parks almost next to each other in neighboring basins. This is because all these parks have a different character and a different purpose. This is the Rijnhaven Park. You could say that this one is the central park within the central park. It is centrally located near a subway station. Included in this area development are a couple of high-rise buildings and around 3,000 houses. And the attraction of this park is going to be the urban beach. And also, Rotterdam doesn't have a beach yet at the New Meuse, also because it's dangerous, but here we think we can make it safe behind the bridge within the basin. And also we want to make the water itself as an explicit part of the park. So this is the place where you can swim, when you can go canoeing, supping, and so on. So no motorboats behind the bridge, maybe only the water taxi. On the sides, we will make floating parks so that you will have a different way to get close to the water. And here, floating buildings can be attached to the park. So we now, for a couple of years, have the UN Climate Office, and we have a floating hotel. Then, adjacent, we have the Maashaven Park, also called Nelson Mandela Park. This you could call the Volkspark. So this is really for the people of the southern part of Rotterdam, where they live in densely populated areas with not a lot of green public space. Heat stress also is an issue here. This park can reduce the temperature with about around 7 degrees, I've been told. And it's just going to be a fabulous park with nice places to hang out, to meet, to do urban sports, or to visit an event. The third park, Feyenoord Tidal Park. This one is just like the Rijnhaven Park, as you can see, part of a larger area development. But opposed to the other two ones, this one is not situated in a basin, but it's situated at the mainstream of the river. And here we chose to go for a really natural tidal park. And in order to create a calm area where the nature will not erode from the flush, the stream, we make this long dam or foreshore. And this one will be connected to an island, which is not on the picture, but it's over there. So the idea is that you have a long linear tidal park, which is a quiet area combined with more busy jetty walks near the quay. And actually, we see these as fantastic incidents, but the real ambition is to connect all these incidents into one coherent green-blue network throughout the city. with the Central Park as center. Yeah. The water level fluctuates 1.5 meters twice a day. I guess you have way more here in Hamburg. So we have to help people to see this because I think many people don't even know, which is logical because you can hardly see. We have many straight quay walls in red or rocky sloping riverbanks in black. So what we do, we make a variety of tidal parks in all kinds of forms, big and small. This is an easy example. So we make stairs, like here at the Westerkade. This enables people to see the difference between low tide and high tide. And this also enables people to get close to the water, which really is a need of people to be able to touch the water, as long as they don't go swimming. Keilehaven, this is also some kind of stairs, but then a more natural one, which really has added value for biodiversity. And the funny thing is that this one, this design, this is being realized now, but this design recently won an inspiration award at our national real estate fair, which is really news to me that a park can win a prize at a real estate fair. I guess that's good news. Then we have Feyenoord Tidal Park and the Brine North Island, which will be connected. This is a picture of the Brine North Island. This is a really quiet oasis within the city. We really chose for a natural landscape here that changes every hour. So if you walk around here, you can see it changing. Rijnhaven Park, so opposed to the previous one, this one is the most public, the most crowded version of a tidal park, the urban beach. And the Maashaven Park, actually here we wanted to go for, initially wanted to go for a tidal, a natural tidal park as well, like the Feyenoord one. But we couldn't get the city council really enthusiastic for it. And once we decided that this had to be a park for people at the first place, we really got it going. So the emphasis is a bit different. There still is tidal nature, but the emphasis is on the people. And one aspect in the design are those hills, so that you can see on top of the hill, you can see the size and the scale of the bassin, and you can also see the vessels, the binnenschiff, laying in the bassin, which are really important for the identity of this area. And this is, I have 5 approaches in total. The fourth is that this Central Park is not only about walking routes, cycling routes, and parks, but it's also about the ships, the boats, which you can see. So what we do is that we also want to invest in the connectivity and the hospitality on the water, because these dynamics are like crucial to the identity of our Central Park. Maybe you have heard of the Watertaxi, maybe you have a similar concept in Hamburg, I don't know yet. But this is quite a success. It's a taxi on the water. It's an addition to the public transport network on the land. And it's also, I would say, mainly a huge tourist attraction. So we have many other passenger ships, like party boats, for example. And the idea is that for all these smaller passenger ships, so not the large cruises, not the sea cruises, not the river cruises, but these type of ships, that we make, we call it gastvrije havens. Not easy to translate, but you could say welcoming ports. So the concept is that we make landing stages, which will be used by several different types of ships, just for a short, like a quick pickup or drop off of passengers, easily to find and to recognize by passengers, a good connection to the transport system on the land, and maybe some rental bikes over here. And also an important thing is that these landing stages are really attractive in design, so that they are landing stage and public space at one. And the idea is to make, to apply this concept at all places near the river where we have really attractive and public sites, so that we create this whole guest-free welcoming network over water. Okay, one last example is that we increasingly are paying attention and want to give space to temporary public functions on the water. Because again, we think that this, for a huge part, defines the identity of the Central Park, like the dynamics of the water, of ships, but also of changing program, changing public spaces. So this is actually now happening in Rotterdam as part of the Rotterdam Architecture Month. These are three Venus ships, inland vessels, which normally transport coal or coals or grain, but they are now rented by a couple of partners, and the city of Rotterdam funds this initiative as well. And they are now transformed into, the first one is a park, the second one is a skating park boulder hall, and this one is an exhibition space where we also tell the story that I'm telling you now. And actually we are, with this initiative, because in a couple of days this will be gone, it's over, the party, but we hope to plant a seed and invite the markets, stakeholders, anyone, and try to get more of these kind of temporary public spaces. This is a really different example of how we use the water temporarily. This is a cruise ship that is used for temporary housing for refugees and refugees that have a permit. I really hope that we as a country will soon be able to give these people a house on the land. But what this learned us is that it's good to have space on the water for unforeseen social matters like these. So the idea is to claim, to reserve some space for this type of initiatives. Because if we don't do so, we will have all the space claimed by other functions. But one example, we have a lot of building initiatives, so many private parties that want to build houses on the water. We have two projects with floating villas already within the city, which are in itself a success, but we asked ourselves a question, do we want more villas within our Central Park? Well, you can guess the answer is no. We do want more housing, but the idea is that we do it at one place and then we do it really good. So no floating villas, but an yes, but an inclusive city district for all types of price classes, how do you say it? But also public space, so public streets that invite people to go in. So we think that this concept could really have added value. I'm really curious to find out how you are working on the transformation of the riverbanks and the water. And I would say be welcome in Rotterdam. Yeah, thank you. Thank you.